Which track are we going now? The first track?
Yeah, let's do the first track first.
One God, one religion. One man, one soul, one God, religion. One man, one soul, one God, religion. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Yeah.
Freddie Mercury was one of the greatest frontmen in the history of music. He electrified audiences around the world night after night, taking tens, sometimes hundreds of thousands of people in the palm of his hand, literally. He could have you screaming at the top of your lungs one second and dead quiet the next using nothing but a hand gesture. It's a magical moment when thousands upon thousands of people are packed into a stadium singing a song that you wrote. What's even more special is if we trace those moments back to their origin, you won't find thousands of people. You will find a single person in a room by themselves trying to find the right sounds that perfectly capture an emotion that is both deeply personal and universally understood. Freddie Mercury was a master of this. His music is just as emotionally resonant today as it was in the 1970s. While the creative process is often an ambiguous exercise, we're lucky that he spoke about his process enough that we're able to put the pieces together to get a better understanding of how he made magic.
One sweep, one front, one clap, one chicken.
Sorry,
the resistance is a term coined by author Stephen Pressfield that represents an internal unseen force that prevents all creatives from sitting down and actually doing creative work. Most artists look at the resistance as something to overcome. Freddie, on the other hand, would use it as a guide. Song ideas had to come to him organically and flow out of him easily. As soon as there was any real level of resistance, he would drop the song and move on to the next. He didn't look at his music as a great art, but rather as escapism for the masses. In order to make something that is widely consumable, it has to be simple enough that everyone can enjoy it. Therefore, the resistance acted as a filter for complex and simple ideas. If a song is simple enough that it can be conceived easily, then one can assume it can also be consumed easily.
The bar records, they see our videos or whatever, or it's like going to see a wonderful film. They go and see them because they have problems. They go in there, so I'm going to lose my problems for 10 minutes or an hour and a half, and then they go back to it. I just want my songs to actually sort of filter through to everybody in a form of escapism. So, that, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, they can buy the record, and when they've heard it, I wish that for 5 minutes or 3 minutes, they're happy. They can then discard it like a tissue.
What inspired a man who entertained millions? Monotonous everyday life. There were never brainstorming sessions or lengthy periods at the piano trying to will the music out. He would just live his life and let the ideas present themselves. The tricky thing with this approach is the ideas leave you as fast as they arrive, so the moment inspiration hits, you have to drop everything you're doing and get the idea down. Waiting for inspiration to hit may seem like an inefficient way of creating, and for most people, it is. But Freddie Mercury was not like most people. His mind didn't stop. He had more song ideas than he had time to work on them, meaning that any time spent trying to force a song to come together was time not spent working on other, better ideas. His method was to get the music out of his head as fast as possible to see what he had in order to determine whether it was worth pursuing or not.
I like to capture a song very quickly so that it's fresh, and then you can work on it afterwards. But I mean, I hate sort of trying to write a song, and if it's not coming, no, come on, let's try this. It either comes quickly, and then you have it, you know, like the basic skeleton, and then I say, yes, we have a song, and now then we can start putting in all the clever bits. But if a song's not happening, I normally just say, oh, forget it, let's try something else.
Freddie Mercury's monotonous everyday life was quite different for most people. The common trap artists fall into is once they find success, they're no longer able to write in a way that their audience can relate to. Freddie didn't have this problem because he didn't write about his experiences, he wrote about his emotion. Emotion is universal, which is why his muse was how different experiences made him feel. Everyone can relate to feeling. No matter how much money someone has in the bank, they've been sad about a breakup at some point.
I'm into basically writing songs about what I feel about. And basically what I feel very strongly about is love and emotion.
What makes a song emotional? If we look at the research paper, The Influence of Musical Structure on Emotional Expression, tempo is typically regarded as the most important component, but a number of other factors such as mode, loudness, and melody also influence the emotional valence of the piece. Notice what's not listed? Lyrics. Freddie knew this intuitively. When writing a song, he would focus on the melody and structure first, with the words almost coming as an afterthought. Like most writers, Freddie didn't like the idea of writing as much as he liked the idea of having written.
So, one God, one soul, make one decision. You know, that you met the three things at the end, the line at the end is as one sentence.
How about that?
one decision. Make two, one true religion. That's good, man.
Once Freddie had a song he believed in, the next step was presenting it to the rest of the band. Queen was unique in that all four members contributed songs for their albums. Naturally, this would result in having far more material than was needed for a record. The solution? Fight about it. The boys would argue, bitch, and moan until they democratically whittled down all available material to the best grouping of songs. It required a certain level of humility to accept that one of your songs just wasn't up to par, but ultimately what came out of these rows is an iconic discography that has stood the test of time. While this may seem like an immature exercise, it was a critical part of Freddie's creative process. He needed to have people who weren't afraid to push back on his ideas, to find their deficiencies so he could make them better. When he did his solo albums, he didn't have that. He was surrounded by yes-men who were all too afraid to provide any criticism, and as a result, his work suffered. It was important for him to be able to stress test his material with the people he respected to know if he really had something or not.
How do you sort out which songs are going to go onto an album? Because you all write, don't you?
What happens is a sort of a very huge sifting process where we sort of find out what songs...
Like, no way am I going to play that, or...
Things like that. And we always forget work it. Also, okay. Sort of, as far as the individual song is concerned, and also what will go with how the songs will sort of sound with each other. So it's basically sort of looking in terms of an album.
When it came time to record, Queen gave it everything they had. Most bands come into the studio to record like they're making an album, not Queen. They would bring their world-renowned stage presence into the studio and perform like they were playing for 100,000 people. That energy could be felt on each and every record. The benefit they had in the studio over a live performance was they could fix their mistakes. And they would, again and again and again. Freddie was a perfectionist, and he would make himself and his bandmates repeat a small section of a track until it was just right. He was uncompromising, would do everything in his power to get as close to perfect as possible.
Most of the time, I have a clear picture of what I want, and I sort of have a lot of, say, Roger's parts and what Brian should do. Things. There are rows, of course.
For Freddie, the music was above all else. This included his feelings, your feelings, what did well in the charts, what their management told them to do, what they had the budget for, everything. His priority was making the best record imaginable, pushing beyond what they had done before. He didn't just give the audience what they asked for, he gave them what they didn't even know they wanted. If Freddie felt like weaving opera into a rock and roll song made it better, he'd do it. It didn't matter if everyone else said otherwise, he would always do what was best for the song. The last creative decision Freddie made was to not tell anyone what his lyrics meant. He would always deny any meaning in his music when asked by journalists. It was his wish that everything he created be open to interpretation. That way, each and every person could have their own unique experience when listening to one of his songs. He knew that once he put his art out into the world, it was no longer his. It was for his fans to have and do with as they wish.
It really is up to the listener to make up its interpretation. Especially my songs. I mean, they don't state very categorically. I mean, they're very sort of, they can go into different sort of areas. And I like that, actually. I mean, it's a nice escape for me from the writer's point of view, but I think from the listener's point of view, it's nice that they can make up different interpretations.
Freddie Mercury never did anything he didn't want to do. He was uncompromising, but only follow his interests and urges in all areas of life. How he made his music was no exception. He would follow whatever excited him, create what came most naturally, and refuse to compromise on his vision. It's in this unflinching belief in himself and his art that led to some of the greatest music that's ever been made. Some might even call it magic.